Masculinity theory, or the mere presence of powerful male characters, whether positive or negative, are rampant within the film industry and society as a whole. First discussed under different terminologies in Joseph Pleck, Michael Kimmel, and David and Robert's work, the theory was ultimately coined by Australian sociologist Raewyn Connell in their book titled Masculinities, which was written in 1993, which discussed how masculinity is formed or shaped based on the environment, societies, or cultures prescribed. Masculinity within film is commonly associated with activity, sadism, and furthering of the narrative, according to Gillian Sandel, who is the author of Reinventing Masculinity. But what really does the term masculinity theory really mean? Join me as we delve deeper into the roots of characters within film and modern society alike.
Almost heaven. West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River.
Masculinity theory essentially constructs the overarching features of being a man in a societal regard and applies them to movie characters. Ideas from masculinity theory in the field of gender studies are taken and applied to cinema to generate representations of masculinity by means of how it's performed, discussed, and depicted within the world of film and elsewhere. To make this theory easier to dismantle and analyze, I will be dividing it into three different concepts. The first concept is referred to as hegemonic masculinity, wherein men assume a more dominant position and display attributes that are considered to be the epitome of masculinity. Things like strength, stoicism, power, and dominance are all traits of being a quote-unquote perfect man in society. The second of which is a topic that is widely discussed around the world today, toxic masculinity. If you don't already know what this is, it's basically where harmful qualities of masculinities are portrayed, such as aggressive tendencies, the objectification of women, manipulative behavior, misogyny, and violence, to name a few. Finally, something I like to call emotional responsibility takes the spot as the last key concept that will be discussed in this video. What I mean by this is where common feelings of humans are frowned upon and are considered unmanly when achieving the highest level of masculinity, allegedly of course, like being sad or crying. However, this concept could also double as the acceptance of these natural emotions, where men break these unrealistic boundaries and show a genuine level of humaneness. Now that these descriptors have been noted, let's begin by analysing the idea of hegemonic masculinity. Arnold Schwarzenegger, Ryan Gosling, and Harrison Ford are all actors who come to mind when you think of who plays hard-boiled characters in film, ranging from the Terminator in The Terminator, Agent K in Blade Runner 2049, or Han Solo in Star Wars A New Hope. All of these characters share something in common: their resourcefulness and durability in the face of adversity.
I'll be back.
In The Terminator, Schwarzenegger makes his appearance in perhaps the film he is best known for. He plays a powerful cyborg referred to as T-800 who was sent from the future to search and destroy a future leader of the resistance against technology. Schwarzenegger's character displays little to no human emotions in the film, as he is merely a robot. This is a good example of stoicism concerning hegemonic masculinity. But not only that, the Terminator is also extremely strong and relentless in achieving its program goal of killing the target. In Star Wars A New Hope, Harrison Ford is the iconic Han Solo, a talented space smuggler whose drive is his ego and basically growing his cash flow. Solo is a selfish and overconfident rascal who has no regard for authority figures. Despite these apparent negatives about his character, Solo still displays an immaculate amount of charisma, especially when he is trying to charm Princess Leia Organa, and is extremely competent in difficult situations. These attributes of overconfidence and resourcefulness as a character relate back to our key concept, even when the Terminator and Han Solo couldn't be more different to each other.
Hello, handsome.
What a day, dude. You look lonely. I can fix that.
Yet, the protagonist of Blade Runner 2049, simply known as Agent K to his associates, displays similar attributes to Sola. In the Blade Runner universe, K is a replicant, essentially a replica of a human biologically manufactured by a corporate entity called the Tyrell Corporation. K is nothing more than a police enforcement officer for the LAPD in the dystopian city of Los Angeles and is often treated as subhuman by his superiors due to his replicant status. Despite this, K displays a resounding amount of characteristics reflective of the concept of hegemonic masculinity. Agent K, throughout the story of Blade Runner 2049, is a man of few words and is extremely professional when following the objective set for him, often displaying no-nonsense behavior, but at the same time is emotionally complex due to his exploration into a case that led him to believe that he was potentially a real human being. I won't spoil the rest of it for you, since I highly recommend the movie, but Agent K is efficient in his work, being an autonomous individual who quickly resolves any issues at hand. On the other end of the spectrum, however, lies characters who represent toxic masculinity. Perhaps the two most fitting examples of this are Patrick Bateman, played by Christian Bale in American Psycho, and the infamous Joker, played by Heath Ledger in The Dark Knight. American Psycho is a film that follows the life of Patrick Bateman, an investment banker. Among his obsession with image and self-preservation by following fashion trends and conforming to society, Bateman is also an extremely violent and discriminatory individual, hence the title of the film, American Psycho. As the film progresses, the audience can see the eventual decay of Bateman, with his morals becoming less apparent, whereas his violent and psychotic personality emerges from the surface. Patrick Bateman also objectifies and mistreats women, which is also a telltale sign of toxic masculinity in the modern era.
Harvey Dent never made it home.
Of course not.
What have you done with him?
Me? I was right here.
On the more supervillain side of things, Heath Ledger's Joker in the Dark Knight saga is a deranged miscreant who frequently engages in the manipulation of others and domestic terrorism to achieve his goals of not only challenging Batman and the civilians of Gotham City, but also the boundaries set by modern society. In line with the attributes commonly associated with toxic masculinity, the Joker is a misogynistic individual who, like Bateman, objectifies women and views them as disposable objects as a means to personal gain, but obviously on a much larger standpoint. As a sociopath, the Joker is detached from any positive emotions and is instead fueled by pure hatred and the idea of non-conforming. While there are more tame examples of toxic masculinity in film, I feel like these two characters are perfect for hyperbolizing this key concept. Finally, we have the key concept of emotional responsibility. Tom Hanks and Jamie Bell are two instances where actors portray characters reflective of this key concept.
Hey, dummy! Are you retarded or just plain stupid?
Forrest Gump, the protagonist of Forrest Gump, is played by Tom Hanks in what some may consider to be one of the most iconic films of recent times and takes the concept of emotional responsibility and implements it into Forrest. Despite his low intelligence discussed in the film, Forrest Gump constantly displays genuine emotion with a disregard for the unrealistic expectations of being a man, like the attributes related to hegemonic masculinity. In the film, Gump grows up alongside Jenny, a young girl from a poor family whom he turns to view from a romantic perspective as he grows up. Unfortunately for Gump, Jenny does not share the same feelings as he does and constantly ignores the prospect of being in a relationship with him and exploits his innocence during their time together as friends. Even after being drafted into the Vietnam War, Gump writes letters to Jenny and stays loyal, but is met with silence. Gump's caring personality furthers this concept of emotional responsibility, as he helps nurse his former CEO, Lieutenant Dan, back to mental health after being discarded by the US government as a disabled individual. All in all, Gump is a perfect representation of the previously mentioned concept of emotional responsibility, as no matter how bad life can get, he stays positive and remains a strong example of true masculinity.
Drill Sergeant.
Is that clear?
Yes, Drill Sergeant!
From a different part of the world, Jamie Bell's Billy Elliot, in the film named after the character, is another example of emotional responsibility where Elliot puts aside societal norms to follow his passion for ballet in order to express himself. Coming from a relatively poor family in the north of England, Elliot is enlisted into boxing classes as he's just a young lad. But in the same location where those boxing classes take place, there are ballet classes happening, which draws Elliot's attention. Throughout the remainder of the film, Billy Elliot shows determination in the pursuit of achieving his goals of being skilled in the art of ballet, despite all of the setbacks that occur in the film, such as the miners' strike, leaving his family with less money, or the ridicule he faces from his father. During this journey, Billy Elliot is also set on a path of self-discovery as he learns to not be afraid of expressing himself. Like Forrest, Billy Elliot is no stranger to an arduous journey, whether that be in the rice fields of Vietnam or in a homophobic England. To finish off this video essay, I'd like to discuss just one more thing. Does this concept of masculinity theory always represent men in films in a balanced light? Well, it is clear from my discussion that what we may consider negative portrayals of masculinity are a lot more common than positive ones, especially now that patriarchal societies are experiencing rapid change in terms of the dominant aspect of the male sex, which is now being viewed as a negative in the modern world due to the progression of feminism. I'd also like to bring up the argument that perhaps the descriptors of this theory, especially how it's stated based on historical context, is getting a bit outdated because of how it was declared in the late 1980s. Societies are now developing new definitions of masculinity. With the acceptance of LGBTQ minorities, I wonder as to how masculinity theory can be redefined to fit this new social structure in the West. Regardless, I'd like to end off with a little quiz from what you might have learned from me today. First, could you give me any other examples of toxic masculinity or emotional responsibility in films? Secondly, do you think this type of theory will still be used to develop meaningful characters? And third, do you think this theory is needed to develop such characters? Well, write your things in the comments. Thank you very much. That's all from me. Thank you and good night.